Hey everyone, Cynics here. It's always important to remember that presentation is an essential part of being an artist. I die just a little inside every time I see someone share a traditional drawing or sketch online without taking even just a few seconds to pretty things up a bit. In this video, I shall go over the most basic ways to clean up your art, as well as some of the more advanced and interesting tricks you can do to make your traditional drawings look extra presentable. Alright, so let's try some stuff out. Here's my current sketchbook, and I'll just open it up to the most recent page, which has some life drawing sketches from earlier in the week. I certainly don't have any fancy setup for taking pictures of sketchbook pages. I'm just going to use my crappy, outdated smartphone to take some quick pictures in this regular indoor lighting. Now that I've done that, let's hop into Photoshop and see what we've got. If our goal is to simply share the sketchbook page as it is, then the bare minimum we can do is crop the image to get rid of any background elements or sketchbook binding. A quick use of the image auto adjustment features will usually make your drawings pop a bit more. Of course, we can do much better than that. I suggest manually adjusting the saturation a bit to remove any bounced color light that came through in the photo. Fine-tuning the brightness and contrast by hand is the next step up after using those simple auto-adjust features. This has all been pretty standard beginner stuff so far, so let's get a tad more complex. You may notice the main problem with just taking a random picture of your sketchbook is that unless you have some amazing great lighting setup, the brightness will always be very off balance. On this image, you can see that the left side of the page is noticeably darker than the right side. We need to have an even contrast among all the line work in order to have a nice presentation. So, one tool you can use is the Quick Mask tool. It's this little circle in a box icon over here. When you toggle it, it takes you into Quick Mask mode. Here you can select the Gradient Fill tool and use a simple transparent gradient to select the darker side of the image. Quick Mask is great because it lets you make selections with soft edges and gradiented edges and everything like that. So now, when you click the Quick Mask tool again and toggle it off, you should see a regular looking selection box around the gradient you made. While it looks like a normal selection, I assure you, the selection is actually dynamic and gradiated. You can always invert the selection too if you selected the wrong side, which seems to happen to me about half the time. Now that we have a gradiated selection to match our gradiated lighting, we can simply go back to brightness and contrast and adjust the brightness slightly. If your selection was good, you should wind up with a pretty even result. You can always repeat this process as much as you want. Now is a good time to mention that the levels adjuster is quite a bit more functional than the simple brightness and contrast sliders. I like to use the levels sliders for all of the final tuning of values. Okay, so that's all well and good, but what if you wanted to rearrange the sketches or make a collage or just make sure you really keep a nice looking paper texture on the page? Well, you're in luck because next I'm going to show you my super secret technique that actually works better than the previous method in most cases and allows you much more flexibility in your presentation. I'll demonstrate this by preparing an Instagram post as I normally do. Here's the trick, you just need to have a nice, even lit blank paper picture that you can reuse for everything. If you have just one nice image of a blank sketchbook paper with no gradation in lighting, then you'll never have to take a perfectly lit picture of your sketchbook ever again. Now I can go back to my mediocre cell phone picture and simply cut out all of the sketches and doodles I like and throw them onto the Photoshop file with that nice paper background. Once you have the pieces, you just need to clean them up. First, set the sketch layers all to multiply. Now just adjust away. A quick auto adjust or brightness contrast adjust will get it halfway there, but you really need to use levels to get it perfect. When you open up levels, you'll probably notice a giant black mountain on the right side of your levels slider. Just take the right slider and pull it toward the other side of the mountain. This will make the paper color a near perfect white, which, when used with multiply, means it simply disappears. Repeat this process for all of the sketches you wanted to throw in, and then you get to play around with composition a bit. A quick compositional tip, faces are very important landmarks, so make sure you stagger the height of each face slightly to make sure the viewer's eyes aren't traveling on a straight line. Another compositional tip, you generally want faces to point toward the center of the image, as humans instinctively look toward the spot where we see other faces looking. This means that if a drawing of a face is near the edge of the canvas and looking off of the canvas, the viewer's instinct will be to look off of the canvas as well. The main goal of composition is to keep the viewer's eye on the page and circling around as much as possible, so we never want to lead their vision off the canvas. Anyway, enough about that. I think I have a reasonable composition for the parts available, so now I can simply erase the parts of the sketch that overlap with the more dominant parts. That's really all there is to it. Now we have our sketches presented in a very pleasing way with nods to composition and balance thrown in. It certainly beats just sharing the page as it was without any adjustments. And if you did things properly, no one will ever be able to tell that it was digitally altered. I will mention these sketches were done in ballpoint pen, which makes the adjusting phase a bit easier, but you can certainly do this method with pencils and any other light media. It will just take a more careful and mindful sense of value adjusting. Alright, I'm going to do one more example and possibly try a couple other tricks. I have some decent faces on these pages that I didn't use for the Instagram post, so I think I will try using them to make a thumbnail for this video. Here I have my image of a nice big blank sheet of sketchbook page. Now I can just bring in a few of the faces and zoom through those previous steps all over again. I think I will actually break my previous compositional advice and lump all of these faces together into a singular shape. If the face on the left wasn't sharing a silhouette with the other faces, I think it would be a terrible choice to place it facing off the side of the page. But as a combined singular object, I think it will work. Once again, each layer is set to multiply and adjusted until you can only see the lines. Make sure you don't unintentionally darken the lines too much either, because that will start to make things look unnatural. After each of the overlapping back layers is properly erased, I have my nice cohesive collection of faces. Now for fun, I want to add a graphical punch. Normally, it would be really difficult to add a graphic element in Photoshop and keep things looking traditional. But there are some tricks for this, so I'm going to need to prepare a new sketchbook page that I can use for filling in dark areas. Luckily, I found an old black Prismacolor marker here. I'm just going to make a nice even fill of strokes until I have a big solid area. Now I'll just take a quick picture and I should have a nice photo to use in plenty of future projects. Let's test it out! I'm going to copy a chunk of the fill area and paste it into my thumbnail project over here. Don't forget, I still need to set it to multiply and adjust out the white paper areas. I think a slight angle on this would work out pretty nicely, so I'm going to try that out. Erasing out the areas behind the face is a bit of a pain, but it should be worth it in the end. I think that's looking alright. Next, I'm going to add some text for the title of the video. I like to keep my text simple and blocky most of the time. Of course, the color of the text is breaking my traditional vibe a bit too much. Luckily, Photoshop has a convenient layer masking feature. If I copy more of my marker fill over the area with the text, I can alt-click on the line between the two layers, and this will make a clipping mask. We can also use this same feature to cut out some text from our main graphical fill area. If we just add some pure white text and use it as a clipping layer with our marker fill, it will use the multiply effect on the other layer to make the text look like a cutout. Unfortunately, the clean edges of the text are far from traditional looking, but unless you wanted to really get in there and make each letter look a little bit ragged and rough, this is about the best you can do. Anyway, that's going to do it for this video. Now you have no more excuses for bad looking sketch uploads. I hope you learned something new from this video, and as always, thank you so much for watching, and thank you to all of my patrons who have actually just reached a new milestone, which means a special new project is coming. More on that later though. See you, everyone.